Hi, everybody. I'm Jill Lepore, and I'm really happy to be here today with all of you to talk about privacy. I want to welcome all of you to the New Yorker Festival, although you've probably been here all weekend enjoying many excellent events. I have some little reminders I'm supposed to offer up to all of you. Please silence your cell phones and don't take any pictures. These are privacy concerns, so very apt for us here. I'm going to talk for about an hour. I have a whole mess of slides we're going to look at, and then I'm happy to take questions for a while from all of you. These are actually, I'm going to give you a kind of very fast-paced history of American ideas about privacy that derives actually from some work I've been doing for a few years now, thinking about privacy, which actually partly comes out of a book that I've just written about Jane Franklin, Benjamin Franklin's sister, who was a person whose ideas about privacy were very different from Franklin's. And these are also somewhat related to a series of lectures I gave last year at the New York Public Library, the Goldman Lecture, so I just want to acknowledge that here as well. Privacy, of course, has been very much in the news lately, and you all know what I'm talking about when I say that we're very anxious people when it comes to privacy. I don't think, though, that we've had really enough vantage on these issues historically. And I'm a historian, and all problems to me appear to be essentially historical problems that could be solved if we would only look at them historically. Like, for instance, if we would think about what was going on in Washington historically, somehow, immediately the government would open up. Okay, that's just totally not true. That's like a historian's fantasy. But I do think that there's a vantage that we can gain here in thinking about this really seemingly entrenched hypervigilance about privacy that affects so many of us today, and our real sense that something that is essentially a fundamental human right is at risk. So I'm going to tell you some stories about actually things that have been hidden and invisible, because I think that's a really interesting way to think about the history of privacy itself. In the winter of 1804, an invisible woman came to New York. Notices of her arrival appeared in nearly every newspaper in the city. For a fee, you could meet her. She lived in a glass box suspended by four cords from the ceiling of a room at the Shakespeare Gallery in the theater district. Through speaking trumpets that poked out of the corners of the box, you could hear her voice. You could even hear her breathing. You could ask her anything. She was terribly chatty. And if you were lucky, she might sing to you. One newspaper reported, "She has come to the city to see, if not to be seen." She had made her debut in Paris 4 years before. La femme invisible, she was called. Everyone wanted to discover her secret. Was someone in the crowd a ventriloquist? No, because the invisible lady could speak to you even if you were alone with her. Was there a woman hiding in the wall, maybe, throwing her voice? Everyone looked, but no one could find her. Did the box somehow conceal a machine? No one could prove it. As the editor of the French Gazette concluded, no other explanation seemed possible than that there really existed an invisible woman. But the invisible woman was, of course, an illusion, a deception. How the hoax worked was revealed even before she crossed the ocean. As explained by the author of a French pamphlet called The Invisible Lady, Her Secrets Revealed, there really was no invisible lady. There was only a woman concealed in the ceiling, her voice having some distance to travel, amplified by tubes and trumpets. When she wanted to see her visitors, she pressed her eye against a peephole in the floor. But the publication of the explanation in France did nothing to diminish the curiosity's appeal here in the United States. There weren't really spoilers back then. It's not like you could post online the invisible lady's secret and it would be wrecked for you. She was displayed in Philadelphia beginning in 1800 and then in 1804 all over the country, from Boston to Baltimore, from Washington to Cincinnati. The invisible lady was for decades the most popular attraction in the United States. It does seem kind of obvious that it was a hoax, doesn't it? I don't know. It's a little... Maybe they were more gullible then. By 1805, there inevitably, of course, turned up in Charleston, South Carolina, an invisible man. He lived in a box the size of a coffin and was looking for an invisible wife. That she should have proved so popular for so long, I find quite bizarre. The exhibit's premise seems so preposterous, so difficult to credit. I mean, think about it. If you were invisible, would you go live in a box? Like, if you were invisible, the whole point would be you could sneak around. It just seems so wrong. Also, that's what cities are for, right? This is early urbanization. People go live in cities in order to hide out, to be unfound, to be hidden, to be disguised, to be invisible, to be anonymous. But she actually put herself on display in a box of glass, which, I'm sorry, is the very last thing you would do if you were invisible. But that's one of the things that made her so interesting. She wishes to be displayed, but she does not wish to be seen. And I think in that way, she looks less like an emblem of her times than like a premonition of ours. She's not alone in that box, unwilling to be unknown, in a cage, on a stage, behind like a glass podium. It's like the invisible lady right here. To live inside that kind of a box is to chronicle our lives on Facebook, for instance, while demanding the latest and best from a species of cryptography known as privacy protection. To live inside that invisible box is to register for an account on Twitter using a password, a cipher of numbers and letters, so that no one can violate the selves we have so entirely contrived to expose. That invisible box, then, is a paradox. Inside that box, this box, the checkbox where we ask our machines to remember us, the box where all of us live now, the only thing more cherished than privacy is publicity. Exposing, then, the history of this paradox, trying to figure out where did that even come from? Why is there such a paradox? And what can we do about it if there's something that needs to be done about it? I think requires thinking about three different things: mystery, secrecy, and privacy. And that's what I'm going to mainly talk about here today. I'm going to try to give you a history of these three different ideas, because I think that they constitute a transformation over the last few centuries. And so what I'm going to argue here is that much that was once mysterious became secret, and then it became private. So I'm going to give you some definitions so we all have some common ground. Mystery is what we can't know but are asked to believe. Secrecy is what is known but not to everyone. And privacy is what allows us to keep what we know to ourselves. Their meanings are actually overlapping, as you can see, but I think there's actually a kind of chronological shift over time among them. Mystery is the oldest of these ideas. And for most of its history, the word mystery had a distinctly religious meaning. Immortality, for instance, is a mystery. Secrecy is mystery yielding to science. Scientists want to uncover the secrets of aging. And one way of understanding privacy, as it's most commonly used today, is that it's mystery made secular and secrecy made into a matter of law. So, just to get my argument restated, much that was once mysterious became secret, and then it became private. It moved from these realms, from the realm of the religious to the realm of science, to the realm of law. How does that work? Think about a few more of the more obvious examples. Think about, for instance, conception. Anciently invoked as one of God's mysteries, conception was later studied by anatomists as the secret of generation. And finally, or at least most recently, the act of conception, or the prevention of that act, have been defended against intrusion by citizens using the language of a constitutional right to privacy. Uncovering the secrets of generation required a conviction that that wasn't heresy, but it also required tools, technological tools, that made it possible to see what was previously unseen. Only after that happened could conception become private in our modern sense. You can make the same argument about a lot of different kinds of things, I think. Or actually, once you think this way, everything looks to you just to move from mystery to secrecy to privacy. But think about, for instance, blood. The idea that our blood is a mystery that only God understands, then it becomes a secret whose circulation we can begin to penetrate through the lens of science. And finally, we adopt notions that what is in our blood is private and should be known only to us. The mysterious becomes secret, for instance, when what lies inside a woman's body becomes exposed, or when what lies inside of our blood is made visible. Only then comes privacy. And this is an important point, because at least insofar as I see it, the case for privacy comes after and never before the act of exposure. Which means to say, which is another way of saying, the case for privacy always comes too late, which is one of the explanations that I have for the kind of anxiety, the acute anxiety that many people feel today about electronic surveillance, that the case for privacy has come too late. The history of proof follows a similar trajectory. It goes from stigmata to footprints to DNA, from the realm of the religious to the realm of law. In matters of evidence, mystery yields to secrecy and then to privacy. Okay, so that's just a theory. You could take it or leave it, but if it's true, what are we supposed to do with that knowledge? How does that explain anything that's going on today? And what are we supposed to do in terms of how we understand the lives that we lead? Well, one thing I think we need to do is to think more clearly about the history of technology. Because one of the ways that we can illustrate this change from mystery to secrecy to privacy is by looking at the very tools that make possible moving something from what is from the realm of the hidden to the realm of the seen. So, for instance, the printed book, which ushers in the end of the age of mystery, yields to the camera, which exposes the secrets of the natural world. And then more recently, the book that's also a camera invades our privacy. I want to go back and talk a little bit about how these ideas evolved over time to try to persuade you of my argument about the relationship between mystery, secrecy, and privacy. A mystery in Christian theology is what God knows and man cannot. It's usually in the plural. There are many mysteries, the mysteries of God. The wisdom of God is a mystery, even the hidden wisdom with God hath ordained before the world unto our glory. A mystery is beyond the knowledge of any mortal. It exists beyond the capacity of any man. This idea changed a great deal during the Reformation, when Protestants began to believe that this conception of a mystery was itself pagan. Then a mystery came to move from the realm of the gods to the realm of man. So then the mystery was what the prince could know, but the rest of us could not. So a mystery of state came to be used to describe, for instance, the royal prerogative, the powers that the King of England has, that no other mortal has. That which concerns the mystery of the king's power is not lawful to be disputed, it was said. You can find evidence for this use of the language of mystery and the mystery of state all over the place in 17th century England, where most of our ideas about politics are formed, the ideas that we would later inherit in the founding of the United States. The idea that there are such things as mysteries of state, knowledge that's known only by the king, but whose publication in books about the secrets of government and the arts of empire makes that knowledge available to ordinary people. And that's part of the revolution that constitutes the great English Revolution and its challenge to royal authority and a new kind of insistence on the authority of ordinary men to understand the nature of government and to control it. There's another meaning of mystery that evolves in this same period, which you probably can also think of easily, which is the notion that a mystery is what a tradesman has, a sort of tradesman's secrets. If you were indentured here, Benjamin Franklin indenturing one of his nephews into the printing trade is taught the art and mystery of printing. That meant that all kinds of knowledge eventually came to be understood as mysteries that could be revealed here in a book of knowledge that reveals, among other things, the mystery of husbandry. A mystery came to be a wholly secular meaning by the end of the 18th century. A mystery was what could be revealed in a book that you could read. It wasn't knowledge just meant for God. It wasn't some power that only the king wielded. It was anything that you could find out merely by learning. It was, of course, at just this moment in the history of the world that the United States is founded, and that's one of the reasons that we have such a peculiar inheritance around this set of ideas. Our Declaration of Independence was meant to make visible the mystery of state, to insist that we would declare in writing and then in print. The Declaration was printed in newspapers and in broadsides all over the country, as was the Constitution, that we would make our laws visible. We wouldn't have an unwritten Constitution as England did, that we would end the mystery of state by publishing the rules of our society, that the body of laws that govern our lives would be published and available to anybody. That also meant, though, that another meaning of mystery became popular, which is the meaning that maybe most people think of today when you hear the term mystery. You think about a mystery novel. So in 1794, The Mystery of Udolpho, Anne Radcliffe's first Gothic novel, is published here in New York and is met with endless imitations. The word mystery comes to mean any Gothic story involving something mysterious that happens that would appear initially to be supernatural, but on closer inspection has actually been merely the workings of mere mortals. So that term mystery is used here in 1804 in the title of a play that's performed in New York in 1804, just in the same gallery where The Invisible Lady appeared later that year. So when the Invisible Lady appears in the Shakespeare Gallery in 1804, she's described in the language of mystery. She's displayed in a room called a temple, that there's a kind of evocation of the religious meaning of mystery. But newspaper advertisements for the Invisible Lady also called her room a cabinet. And they talked about how the philosophers of Paris had been unable to discover her secret, but it was hoped that the people of New York, cleverer than the people of Paris, would be able to unveil her mystery. No one actually really believed that there was such a thing as an invisible lady. Like, people weren't totally so sold on the host, on the hoax. The idea was, the fun of the whole exhibit was to try to figure it out, to actually be what would have been in another century heretical, to go into a temple and not accept the mystery, to do the sort of Protestant thing and actually attempt to deduce by the application of your reason what it was that was going on here. The editors of the Charleston Courier, where the Invisible Man was exhibited, made this argument very explicitly. If we could suppose that the sciences and the phenomenon of the natural world had been as closely investigated and as well understood in former times as they are at this day, we should have little occasion to be surprised at the deceptions practiced by monkish cunning on the people, or at the miracles which were believed to be performed by the churchmen of Rome. In other words, these exhibits were actually like little tiny reenactments of the Reformation each and every time. You would go into these exhibits and make fun of the church, essentially make fun of the idea that there were mysteries in the world that couldn't be solved by the application of reason. And the application of the art of detection, which was another watchword of the early 19th century and has an equally powerful bearing on how we think about privacy now. When we think about surveillance, we're thinking about the way the NSA is acting as detectives upon us, the way they are intruding into our private lives, the way a detective might intrude into the private lives of someone to solve a mystery about their life. One way to think about that is actually to think about another, the popular attraction that replaced the Invisible Lady after the Invisible Lady was shuttered and put away in the closet. This was this thing called the automaton chess player, which became popular in the 1830s, especially after Edgar Allan Poe went to see it in Richmond, Virginia. Poe decided he wanted to investigate this. So the way this thing worked was you'd go, there's this wooden automaton, you'd go and you'd play chess against it. Benjamin Franklin famously played chess against the automaton chess player in Paris and lost, and everybody lost. But he didn't always win, but he mostly won. And he seemed to be to have an almost supernatural power. What could possibly be controlling this automaton? No one knew. Poe decided to conduct an investigation. He watch the exhibit's owners display the thing. The guy would walk, he would stand behind the cabinet and he would very ceremoniously walk to the front and he would open the doors and let everybody see inside. There was nothing inside that, except for gears and cogs, showed that this thing was a purely mechanical device. It was a genius of mechanics. Poe observed that this was unsatisfying as an explanation, and he published an essay in which he attempted to argue that there was a very small man. Just like the Invisible Lady, it's the same stunt. There's no new trick. That there was essentially an invisible man hidden within the box who was playing the game of chess for this machine by using these sort of rods. Poe then became, of course, obsessed, as we know, with mysteries. Poe's the most important mystery writer of the 19th century and probably really ever in terms of the influence that he later wielded. Poe spent a lot of time thinking about hiding people in boxes and hiding men in walls and revealing their secrets through the act of deduction, penetrating a mystery. There are no crimes that remain unhidden. There are no invisible men in Poe. They are all, in the end, revealed. I'm going to ask you to just listen for a minute to the ending of The Telltale Heart.
It might have been a hand, a clock, but no, louder and still louder. They must hear it. Yet they sit and talk and talk. They must. Of course they do. They know. They do. They're torturing me, watching me, letting it beat so that I... Stop it! Stop it, you devils! Yes, yes, I did it. It's there, under the floor. Oh, stop it! It is the beating of his hideous heart!
That was James Mason. The story of Telltale Heart, the guy's killed a guy and he's hidden him beneath the floorboards. But there are no invisible men. There will be no invisible ladies in Poe. They will all be revealed. We will eventually find that hideous heart. It'll be borne out by its very sound. Poe was obsessed with this idea that he could reveal all secrets, that he could see into the minds of men. His most famous detective, Dupin, can penetrate with his eye alone the secrets of men. He boasted to me with a low, chuckling laugh that most men in respect to him wore their windows in their bosoms, as if he had sort of opened their chest unto them. And so there's a lot in Poe actually about anatomy, and it's about the penetration of the body through the anatomical sciences, but it's about the art of detection, what it means to penetrate a mystery that was once the provinces only of priests. What does it mean actually for mere mortals to have the power to do this penetrating work, to do this detective work? It really changed how everybody thought about the boundaries that limited the space between themselves and other human beings. There's all sorts of funky stuff in the early 19th century. This is one of my sort of favorite things, this fad in the 1840s for daguerreotypes where women would go sit and have themselves photographed breastfeeding their children, which was a way to sort of just, it's just kind of a good visual marker of the different set of ideas about privacy that existed in the 19th century. What it meant to expose oneself was a very different thing, but it was something that was very much in flux. All this rhetoric in Poe and in political writings from the 1830s and 40s has to do with a new set of claims about detection and how we could protect ourselves against the penetration of the detective who was not God seeing into our souls, but was another human being who had a new kind of penetrating power because of the new technologies especially the new technologies of photography. But actually, many people who are obsessed with detection, including Poe in the 19th century, were mainly obsessed with houses, like little houses. Like, what does it mean? This is the 19th century, the great cult of domesticity. Think of the dollhouse or the Victorian dollhouse and the obsession with houses and the boundaries of houses and the obsession with family privacy, the idea that what goes on in your own house is somehow different than what goes on in other houses and is essentially private. You can really sort of think of all of 19th century literature, from Thoreau building himself a cabin to Stowe exposing the mysteries of slavery through a cabin, to William Henry Harrison and John Tyler, the log cabin candidates. All sorts of rhetoric in the 19th century in politics and literature and culture is obsessed with houses, cabins, little cabinets, cabins that we live in that cannot be penetrated, or if they are penetrated, all will be revealed and exposed. And it might reveal ourselves as authentic, and it might reveal us as frauds. But it's those boundaries of the house that sort of matter more than anything else, except for one thing. The only thing that matters more than a house is what you put down on a piece of paper. In 1841, Poe published an essay about secret writing. Poe was obsessed with cryptography, as were a great many people in the 19th century who were thinking about new ways to hide secrets. It used to be that you could hide secrets by writing them down, because very few people could read and write. But the 19th century witnessed the rapid and near universal expansion of literacy, so that suddenly almost everybody could read and write. That's actually terrifying. It's completely more terrifying than the NSA. Like, if you were a monk and you could write stuff down, and you knew that nobody could read it except a few other monks, you just could, there was just no anxiety about secrecy there, right? There's a whole, you just exist in a separate sphere of society, a whole level at which you know that the intimacy of your own mind is protected by the act of writing. Once everybody can write, everybody can read. And people got really, really freaked out, especially freaked out about their mail. So there was a lot of emerging technologies for secret keeping in cryptography. Poe convinced himself that he was a genius at cryptography, and he offered himself actually to the federal government as a cryptographer. He wasn't accepted, but that's only because he was a madman. So we get really, I think, a little hyper of a thing. Oh, so terrified that someone's going to read your mail, or like, God forbid, someone's going to actually steal my phone and read my text, and it's just, I'm going to be exposed in this way that no one in history has ever been exposed before. I'm living in this wholly novel moment in age. Actually, no, you're not, because what was really new was when everybody could write, and then people wrote a lot of letters. And a letter is a little bit easier to break into than your email, actually. If you're thinking about the vulnerability, your vulnerability to exposure, an envelope is a lot easier to open than your email. And writing a letter, at least as people understood it and talked about it in the 18th and 19th century, was to reveal your characters. If you sort of spilled your soul out on the very page, people write with great anxiety about what it means to write a letter. They use these wax seals. They ask, did you get my letter? Can you make sure to burn my letter after you read it? This is just an enormous amount of espionage and intrigue about letters, not least because diplomatic relations are conducted by letter, and there is a lot of burning of mail in the 19th century. I wrote in the magazine a piece earlier this year about a scandal that confronted England in 1844 when an Italian named Giuseppe Mazzini, who was an exile living in London, began to suspect that the British government was reading his mail. And he was a very clever man. And he decided that he would mail himself letters, and he would put little grains of sand, or in some envelopes he put little strands of hair, he put poppy seeds and others, and he mailed letters to himself, and then he mailed these same letters to friends of his. And the letters that went to his friends, they opened them up and the poppy seeds spilled out. The mail that he sent to himself, he would open up, there'd be no poppy seeds. But it was very clever, wasn't it? If you could look at like email version of that, that would be so awesome. You'd have like this super hyper secure feeling. But Mazzini, he was right to suspect that the British government was reading his mail. And he asked a friend to investigate this, a friend who's a member of parliament. The member of parliament initiated an investigation. It led to the revelation on the part of a committee of secrecy that was formed to conduct the investigation. Not only had Mazzini's mail been read, but in fact, there was such a thing as the secret department of the post office, not known as the NSA, which actually, we had been reading people's mail for centuries. It had been so secret that nobody in Parliament even knew about it, except for like the one guy who denied it. So there was this tremendous investigation, and it was issued this report that sort of offered a report on the entire history of mail, the entire history of the Post Service. This story was widely followed in the United States, partly because Mazzini was a Republican. That is to say, he was urging the formation of an Italian republic. He was a revolutionary, and he was a great hero to many Americans. So people in the United States were hugely upset about this. Edgar Allan Poe sat down and wrote the Purloined Letter, I think pretty much in response to the Mazzini scandal. The Purloined Letter comes out the year after. But it actually led to a big debate in Parliament and in the United States about publicity, the idea of publicity. Because what had happened was that Mazzini's mail had been published. It had been made public. There's this great cartoon from the period that illustrates the government here, Paul Pry at the post office, prying into Mazzini's mail. So there's a great deal of political satire, both in the United States and in England, about the scandal. But the question was it right or wrong for the British government to do this? And that got tangled up with the question of whether the doings of the government itself should be made public, which was a bigger question in some ways in the United Kingdom than it was in the United States, where that had been a fundamental premise of the establishment of the United States, that we would end the era of mystery and usher in an age of transparency in government. And in the 1830s and 40s, publicity meant transparency. So the person who was most influential in this conversation in the United Kingdom, but also in the United States, is Jeremy Bentham, who wrote an essay called Of Publicity in 1843 that actually is part of what inspired Mazzini to make the big stink about his mail. Bentham had written, "Secrecy is an instrument of conspiracy. It ought not, therefore, to be the system of any regular government." Bentham is the guy who said, look, the proceedings of the House of the proceedings of Parliament ought to be published, ought to be made public. And not only that, there ought to be a gallery in Parliament, and anybody ought to be able to come in. These people are public servants. There ought to be full and entire publicity with regard to their proceedings, and that anybody who opposed the publishing of parliamentary proceedings was what Bentham called a partisan of mystery. When the Mazzini affair broke out the following year, that is the year after Bentham's essay was published, Mazzini himself wrote about it and quoted from Bentham and argued that secrecy is but another word for fear. Mystery is the name of the beast in the Revelations, the great monster by which was typified all the civil and ecclesiastical corruptions of the earth, and had on its forehead the name written, and that name was mystery. So even this particular affair is very much bound up in the shifting meanings of mystery and secrecy in the 1840s. This tremendous anxiety that has to do with the expansion of literacy, with the rise of photography, and with new ideas about the relationships between peoples and their rulers. In the United States, this whole debate about publicity had a new life, which had to do with how Americans should vote, which came and had a tremendous influence on a shifting set of ideas. Americans used to vote publicly. Like, you would go, here's a painting illustrating the voting scene in a country town. You would go to the polling place, which would usually be outdoors, or it might be at a window in a public building, and you would collect a large and brightly colored piece of paper which would reveal your party affiliation, and you'd be waving it around like a flag, and everybody would know which way you were going to vote. There was no secrecy at all in voting in the early United States, or really in many other places either, for the same reason that legislators vote openly. Like, we know who's going to vote how the next time something is brought before the House of Representatives. And when the vote is taken, we have a roll call so we know who did vote how. The same idea seemed to apply, or appeared to Americans to apply, to citizens. We ought to know how everybody votes. That should be a matter of public record. This was reformed beginning in 1831. When a bunch of American legislators who were really influenced by this idea that what we write should be kept a secret, that's new emerging notions of privacy, began to suggest that we would put our votes in envelopes, that you could bring an envelope, or even that the government ought to supply for you an envelope in which you could put your brightly colored piece of paper. England is inspired by the same set of changes. England adopts the secret ballot in 1872. In 1888, Massachusetts becomes the first place in the United States where people can vote in private. This transformation is actually a little bit different than the other transformations I've talked about. The mystery of state, in which a king is crowned by the hands of an invisible god, yields to a republic in which rulers are elected and the secrets of states are made public. But in a republic, publicity is a virtue. The rise of the secret ballot actually goes in the opposite direction by asking that people vote in a box, in secret. And it has to do with the tremendous shift in the new priority placed not on publicity in that sense of a government being transparent, but on privacy as an idea, as a meaningful idea at the end of the 19th century. And that's why we end up with the ballot box and the concerns that we have about the privacy of our voting today. You can think about this even if you follow the fate of the invisible lady, which really early on in the 19th century, when the exhibit comes to New York in 1804, this is an exhibit that's really kind of playing around with the ideas of mystery and secrecy. There's not actually a lot of ideas about privacy here in the original presentation of the invisible lady. Nobody actually talks about the invisible lady as having anything to do with privacy until 1881, when Thomas Wentworth Higginson writes a book which is dedicated to his daughter Margaret, who I just really like that she's on the bike with him here. It's an awesome picture. In this book, Higginson writes a chapter called The Invisible Lady, in which he talks about that exhibit and what it meant and what its legacy has been. And Higginson argues that the Invisible Lady, which was this thing he had seen in his youth, and everybody, he didn't need to even describe what it was because everybody knew it was the most popular attraction in the United States, that it had kind of somehow had a new life for him in a set of ideas that seemed to trap women and also young girls, and he was thinking here about his daughter growing up, in his sort of fetish for secrecy. These appeals, which still meet us for the sacred privacy of women, are only the invisible lady on a larger scale. For Higginson, privacy had come to mean something that actually applied particularly to women and that actually trapped them and didn't actually provide them with liberty, but denied them liberty. That idea that Higginson had, that he expressed in this book in 1881, finds a very elaborate expression in 1890 in one of the most important law review articles ever written, and which is the basis for most of our legal ideas about privacy today. And that is an essay called The Right to Privacy, published in 1890, written by two Boston lawyers, Samuel Warren and Louis Brandeis. And it's here that Warren and Brandeis argue that there exists, okay, there had no, it's not in the Constitution, it had never been mentioned before, but it had always existed in some way or another, a constitutional right of inviolate personality. They actually came to this idea because Warren was upset about journalists and their intrusion onto his family's private affairs. He had come to believe that his family had lost a right to privacy, and he wanted to insist that it existed. This articulation of the right to privacy is huge in its impact for us today. The rhetoric of it is seen all over the place. It's cited everywhere. And it does make a claim that has endured. But it actually has all kinds of other facets. And you can see them if you look more carefully at the contemporary world in which this essay was written. Think even about Emily Dickinson. Thomas Wentworth Higginson, who was upset about privacy and the ways in which it trapped women, was, of course, Dickinson's most important correspondent. She sent him her poems, which she refused to publish because she preferred to remain private. Dickinson, though, feared not privacy but publicity. She feared exposure to the public eye. Think about a poem of Dickinson's that was published in 1891, a year after Warren and Brandeis's Right to Privacy. "I'm nobody. Who are you nobody too?" And picture here for a moment Emily Dickinson whispering this question to the invisible lady in her box through a trumpet of brass into a box of glass. "I'm not quite nobody. The invisible lady answers, whereupon Dickinson whispers back, "How dreary to be somebody, how public, like a frog." There's something really, I think, powerfully eloquent here about Emily Dickinson's own wrestling with the same, very same set of ideas in the very same cultural matrix that Samuel Warren and Louis Brandeis were working in, thinking about what it means to be trapped in a house and desiring only privacy. She didn't want to live in that box, but she lived in a world whose contradictions help explain how we live now, in a pond of frogs, in which the only thing more cherished than privacy is publicity. In 1890, when Warren and Brandeis defined the right to privacy as a right to inviolate personality, they believed that any violation of that right, peering through keyholes and peeping through curtains, would actually be a kind of wound to your soul that might one day make you mad. They also believed that that right, although it had existed eternally, was only needing to be claimed more recently because of technological changes. In particular, they were concerned about photography. Instantaneous photographs and newspaper enterprise have invaded the sacred precincts of private and domestic life. And they talked again and again about those devices. And they talked about modern life and what were the particular challenges of modern life. People, when they read the Warren and Brandeis essay today, it can feel really fresh to you, because it seems like all of a sudden there's a whole realm of technological change that has invaded our privacy. That's the anxiety that they felt about the intensity and complexity of modern life is very similar to our own, because they crafted that set of ideas, because their set of concerns arise out of the culture that has crafted our set of concerns. Brandeis went on to make an argument about privacy that is taken as scripture today by many privacy advocates in a 1928 Supreme Court case, by which time Brandeis was on the Supreme Court, a case regarding wiretapping. I actually just kind of want to, I'm not going to be able to take this story all the way down to the present, because I think what I really wanted to do was evoke for you the much longer history across time that reveals to us where the ideas that we have that we feel so trapped by and that feel so novel, how they have quite a long history. But I do want to pause at one other moment that I think really well illustrates in a kind of surprising way Brandeis's own ideas and the concerns about privacy that he voiced in 1890 in The Right to Privacy, and then again in 1928 in Olmsted versus the United States. And this is The Invisible Man, which was published in 1897, the novel by H.G. Wells, and then became a motion picture in 1933 when Universal Pictures released an adaptation of it. It stars Claude Rains as Griffin, a scientist who's rendered himself invisible by means of chemistry. And I'm just going to show you a short clip, but in this scene, the invisible man, he's fled his lab, and he's living in a country inn where he's trying to figure out the formula that can allow him to become visible again. And we see, but he does not understand, that he is also losing his mind. So the innkeeper has gone to get the police. He has begged the innkeeper to grant him privacy.
Yeah, keep back, you kids there. Yeah, what's all this?
Keep back there.
Keep back, me? Do you know who you're talking to?
I give you a last chance to leave me alone.
Give me a last chance? You've committed assault, this what you've done, and you can come along to the station with me. Come along now, come quietly, unless you want me to put the handcuffs on.
Stop where you are. You don't know what you're doing.
I know what I'm doing, all right. Come on.
Get hold of him.
Lock him up.
All right, you fools. You've brought it on yourselves. Everything would have come right if you'd only left me alone. You've driven me near madness with your peering through the keyholes and dipping through the curtains. And now you'll suffer for it. You're crazy to know who I am, aren't you? All right, I'll show you. There's a souvenir for you. And one for you. I'll show you who I am. And what I am.
Look, he's all eaten away.
How do you like that, eh?
So if you've never seen The Invisible Man, you have to go rent it, because it's really great. But it also embodies the whole argument that I've been making here, if you think about it, because it really is about the transformation from mystery to secrecy to privacy. Here in this really bizarre scene, a detective, a police detective, right, breaks into someone's house. They peer through the curtains and they peep through the windows, breaks in, intrudes upon one's private domestic sphere, and seeks, you know, "You're crazy to know who I am," the Invisible Man says to the detective. "Well, you can see who I am." And actually, it turns out that if you can see who I am, then I am nobody. Like, the whole story of the Invisible Man is about the uselessness of existing if everybody can actually see you, if your privacy is always exposed, if there is no privacy left, that you are fundamentally and permanently and always and unavoidably seen. It's as if, actually, mortals have ascended to the heavens to see the face of God. Like, how bad would that go? They've refused to leave mystery alone, those policemen and that policeman and the town. Through the art of detection, they have exposed what was hidden to the public eye. And they can find only that there is no God, there is only a man. And they have invaded his privacy, and he has been driven by them mad. In the decades since, of course, 1933, there have been all kinds of changes about how we think about privacy. It has only become more precious. We have only become more concerned about it. A kind of fetishistic culture exists around it. And that has to do with the way in which it is still attached to ideas about mystery and to ideas about religion. The insistence that there exists such a thing as a right to be left alone, which is another way that Warren and Brandeis defined the right to privacy, animates all manner of claims and arguments and litigation and even political movements. It lies, of course, most notably behind Supreme Court rulings legalizing contraception in 1965 and abortion in 1973 and invalidating sodomy laws in 2003. These crucial rulings advance liberty and equality, but the question remains whether grounding the pursuit of them in a right to privacy was ever a good idea. Most recently, the right to privacy has been evoked to protect us from forms of cyber surveillance, especially surveillance conducted by corporations and by governments. Brandeis's dissent in Olmstead versus the United States has become an object of veneration. Many people worry that the digital age marks essentially the end to privacy, the death of privacy, here mourned by privacy advocates from Anonymous at a funeral held not too long ago. To protect against invasions by search engines and data miners and security cameras, privacy advocates marshal arguments made by Samuel Warren and Louis Brandeis in 1890, whose technological concerns were limited to the reporter's notebook and the photographer's camera. And again, it's a question, a good question to ask, whether those concerns apply to the set of constraints we're fighting against today. It might be helpful, I think, then, to remember that one reason this conversation has this kind of intensity is that much that was once mysterious became secret, and then it became private. The forces that drove and continue to drive this transformation from mystery to secrecy to privacy have to do with the acquisition, recording, and dissemination of knowledge. It's all about who can know. And especially with the mechanization and the secularization and the democratization of publication, which is not new. It is not something that happened with the rise of the internet. It's something that has happened over the course of centuries. I, by way of shorthand, illustrated this change thinking about how the printed book ushers in the age of the end of mystery and makes privacy possible, the camera which exposes the secrets of the natural world, and the book that's also a camera which rethink invades our privacy. But the story here, when you then think about it and think about that clip from The Invisible Man, is that something deeper has gone on in the course of this transformation. The inviolability of the self has replaced the inscrutability of God, which is a really complicated transformation to have to reckon with as a culture. But of course, it's not only the government or corporations that are affecting this transformation or who have violated what we consider to be our inviolate selves. We have invaded our own privacy by becoming our own publicists, by creating a world in which the only thing more cherished than privacy is publicity. That paradox of that box. So I want to end with one last clip, an advertisement from earlier this year. And as you listen to it, listen for its allusions to the mysterious, the miraculous, the miracles, the mysteries. And also listen for its allusions to the rhetoric of rights.
The miraculous is everywhere. In our homes, our minds. We can share every second in data dressed as pixels. A billion roaming photojournalists uploading the human experience, and it is spectacular. So why would you cap that? My iPhone 5 can see every point of view, every panorama, the entire gallery of humanity. I need to upload all of me. I have the right to be unlimited. Only Sprint offers truly unlimited data for iPhone 5.
So one last question I want to leave all of you with, and maybe something we can take up in the Q&A, is whether, when thinking about the right to privacy, we ought also to be asking when publicity became a right. Thank you. And I believe there are microphones. There's a microphone in each aisle, so I would love to hear some questions or comments.
Hi, Professor.
Oh, yeah, hey.
I got here first, so I guess I'll go first. I wanted to ask, you seem to be discussing, especially at the end, the notion of the right or the pride of sharing, of broadcasting the self as something that has taken hold in American culture. Are you arguing or do you believe that's primarily a trick that's perpetrated by some of these forces, particularly corporate? Like, are you saying that these ads and this argument is tricking people, or do you think actually, much like the way Brandeis was talking about recognizing or finding a new right, the idea of publicity as a right is something that people actually believe or have a good reason to believe?
Yeah, no, I don't think there's a sort of trickery. We're all being duped by corporations or something. I wasn't trying to make a kind of conspiratorial argument. It's a great question. You know, I think there's a lot of commercialization of people's interest in communicating with one another. But there are deeper forces behind the desire to promote oneself, to sort of put oneself, to publish oneself, that, you know, I haven't talked about the origins of or thought about the origins of. It's a sort of end stage to a process in the democratization of politics, right? At one level, like, it comes from the world of politics as much as from other cultural forces. And I don't think it's like some uniform bad in the world or evil in the world. I think it's worth noting that there's probably an inconsistency between making certain kinds of claims to privacy while endorsing and participating in forms in which we forfeit our privacy for the sake of publicity. Which is not to say, oh, we're a bunch of hypocrites, and I'm not going to be preachy about it. I'm actually saying, well, actually, we should probably think about that, right? Yeah, why don't you go ahead?
Hey.
Hi.
So I've heard it sometimes kind of glibly said that in like 1780, if there were envelopes that the federal government could read through, that they wouldn't sell. But those are sorts of analogies people make. As a historian of the period, can you comment on whether I should believe those sorts of assertions about how...
Wait, I'm sorry, I didn't get that. If in 1780 there were envelopes...
If there were envelopes that only the federal government could read through, that they wouldn't sell. I've heard like privacy advocates try to analogize how the colonial or early American experience would think about federal surveillance in that way.
They wouldn't sell because they would...
Because people wouldn't buy them because they would know the government could read their mail.
I see.
Can you comment on whether or not those sorts of things are accurate?
I think that's pretty nutty, honestly. It's just a kind of... I'm trying to understand where it even kind of could come from as a hypothetical. We can't traverse that distance, I don't think, in that way. In 1780, people didn't have some notion of the federal government in the way that we have a notion of the federal government even as existing. So it's sort of hard to know even where to begin, like kind of conceptually. And, you know, as I've tried to suggest here, the idea, the assertion of that kind of privacy, and especially privacy with regard to something that you would put down on paper, doesn't really come into a fuller flower until the 19th century. So it's sort of, it's too early to fear the government in that sense, or for an ordinary citizen to fear the government. And it's too early for people to be that crazy about their about their mail. So I would, at the very least, I would say where that is set historically doesn't make sense to me as a historian.
Thank you.
Sure, yeah.
You've suggested as a historian that this is all a continuum. Does large scale and inaccurate data analytics change that? which is what we have today.
Yeah, I mean, I should just confess, everything always looks to me like a continuum as a historian. Like, I drink a cup of coffee and I think about the coffee trade in the 17th century. Nothing to me looks like it's new. Everything just comes from someplace else. And just the same old, you know, it's just a different chapter. Everything looks like just a new chapter in something. Like, I just walk around with this, like, timeline in my head. So the large data sets stuff.
Large-scale, inaccurate data analytics. Is that an order of magnitude difference? Because that's what the concern about electronic espionage and electronic surveillance today.
Well, there's a speediness to it that doesn't exist and isn't possible. But let me give you an example. There are these files at the Harvard Business School, at the Baker Library at the Harvard Business School, that are the Dun & Bradstreet records. Dun & Bradstreet were the first credit reporters. They kept these files in the 19th century, and then they donated them. They're actually closed for access because people were worried about the credit ratings of someone in 1851. It's kind of funny. But you can go look at them if you get permission. Anyway, they would send these spies to people's houses. Dun & Bradstreet had offices in Boston and New York. They would send spies to people's houses because they wanted if I'm going to give you a loan, and I'm going to come to your house, and I'm going to interview your maid, I'm going to interview your next door neighbor, I'm going to go to the neighborhood saloon and see if you ever drink, and then write an entire character report on somebody and send it to Dun & Bradstreet, which would then make copies of it and send it to their other offices, and you would be nailed, whether what I found out about you was right or wrong. So when I think about those data, and when Google is trying to figure out what I want to buy and what my Visa limit is, or I don't know, whatever they're trying, I don't know what they're trying to figure out. Like, I wouldn't know what Dun & Bradstreet were trying to figure out either. It doesn't seem that novel to me as an act, because it has to do with the rise of a certain kind of commercial interaction, essentially, right? It's about commerce. Nevertheless, it's very speedy. What took me a long time to talk to your saloon tavern? And actually, maybe I would get better information, and it would be more subjective, and there would be a kind of humanistic quality about it. And there wouldn't be, I mean, there are thousands and thousands, tens of thousands of records in that thing. That's just a tiny droplet compared to the amount of data you're talking about. And whether it's accurate or not accurate, I can't say which would be more accurate or less accurate. But it's the instantaneousness of that strikes me as most different.
I'm sorry, I know more about Dun & Bradstreet than I might like to, but I was not referring to that sort of data collection. So just to clarify.
Yeah.
The concern today is government surveillance and government data collection.
Yeah.
Do you see that as quantitatively different than the post office in the Mazzini case, or do you see it as the same?
It's absolutely quantitatively different. There's very little between now and 1840 that quantitatively isn't different. I mean, the scale of it is quite different.
But you don't see the phenomena as different, the ease of it as different.
The technological, indisputably, the ease of it is different. That's what I was sort of alluding to with regard to the speed of it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
My question is about the last word you were using, publicity. And you say we're forfeiting. We want privacy, but we're willing to forfeit it for publicity. And I'd like you to hear you talk about that word, because when I think about the things I do with my iPhone, that in which I'm, publicity might be the appropriate term, I'm looking for community, communication, and knowledge. So if you could just say more about that word. Word publicity.
Yeah, absolutely. And part of the issue is that the meaning of the word has changed so much over time. And actually, that's one of the things that Brandeis and Warren talk about, that the meaning of publicity has changed. Publicity used to just be a uniform good thing. It would be good to be open about things. It's good to have an open government. It's good for reporters to have open access. There are all kinds of ways in which openness is a public good. They came to think that maybe publicity had a downside. And that was that reporters in particular seemed to feel that they ought to be able to intrude into people's private lives if those people happen to be public figures, and that this was a public bad. And so they sort of want to redefine publicity as a bad thing. Then what happens is publicity becomes the term, the operative term in public relations, which emerges in the 20th century, like you think of the 1920s and, you know, Edward Bernays and stuff like that, the golden age of public relations, when publicity comes to mean hiring somebody to make sure other people know more about you than they would know if you just told them yourself, like having a loudspeaker, basically, that says only a very specific thing about you, trying to control the intrusions on your private life by broadcasting specific message about yourself. And that was related to commercial activity exclusively, and then later to then became, of course, like defines political activity now. But you could say, and this is what I was trying to sort of get at, that that's become far more democratized. Like, we all are our own PR agent now. Like, in that's in good ways and bad. Like, that there are good reasons for, well, I don't know, you know, a movie star from the 1920s to have a public, there are all kinds of goods that accrue from that. But we also broadcast things about, particular things that we choose to broadcast about our lives, both to a smaller circle and to larger circles. We, maybe publicity is not the right word to use, absolutely. And there's a incredible good that comes from that kind of communication and the kind of community that people enjoy, and also the incredible spread diffusion of knowledge that's part of that. Like, I'm just giving you a kind of negative thing as I'm trying to sort of ask us to think about the downside of making claims to privacy. So the word is kind of tangled, unfortunately. And that's partly what I wanted to illustrate, the shifting history of the term and where that leaves us. I don't know. I think we need some other words to talk about what's going on. Yeah.
Hi. Thank you. As I was listening to your very interesting talk, I was thinking of an example of how these ideas about secrecy and mystery and privacy have sort of collided and come into conflict in the modern world. And that example is the ways in which many European societies, and especially France and now apparently Britain, have been trying to deal with the desire of certain devout Muslim women to keep their faces covered in public. And it strikes me that, you know, much as we worry about the invasion of our privacy, that there's a sort of a countervailing claim to a public identity that is seen to be important in democratic societies. And perhaps that is why many of us are uncomfortable with the idea of people going around with their faces covered in public. And I wondered, you know, if you have anything to say about that countervailing claim to presenting a public identity and how that works in an environment in which we are very concerned about privacy.
Yeah, that is a fantastic question, and I didn't get to that at all in any way, but that's many dissertations to be written in that, sort of the cross-cultural and intercultural tensions and different trajectories of those histories. I think you're absolutely right that it's on the one side a set of ideas about openness that have a very specific history that come in to conflict with a set of ideas that exist. You know, it's a different chronology, it's a different history, it has a different trajectory. And we would understand, I think, the conflict better if we understood both sides quite a bit better as well. I mean, there's an insistence on openness, but we know what's too open, like Carlos Danger is too open. but what's too closed? You know, that's kind of a trickier thing. Like, Mitt Romney doesn't want to reveal his tax returns. A lot of people think that's just wrong, right? Like, that's too closed, you're a public figure. But, you know, it's a really sort of shifting thing. It really does fundamentally come down to a set of ideas, I think, here in the United States, at least, that most of those ideas devolve to some fundamental assumptions about democracy.
And how much does someone who is not claiming to be a public figure and has no desire to be a public figure have an obligation to have a public identity?
Yeah, I don't know. What's the answer to that? I think zero, man. No, zero. Yeah.
Thanks for a great talk. I really enjoyed it. My question dovetails pretty nicely off the last two.
Yeah.
I actually am writing a dissertation roughly on...
Yay! Question. What's your dissertation called?
At the moment, it's called Hermeneutic Privacy.
Okay, that's scary. Yeah. Did you guys hear that hermeneutic privacy? You like swallowed that word. Hermeneutic privacy.
I try to not just talk to philosophers. I'm
okay.
Change my title. My question is, you framed the distinction between publicity and privacy as being, as these two things being in sort of tension with one another, and you called it a paradox. And I like how you ended asking about us to think about the history of publicity more. And my question is, maybe we get into some of the problems that we seem to find ourselves in, especially legally, because we think of these two things as being in tension with one another. And I wonder if we might be better off thinking about privacy as what we need in order to sort of have agency with our own publicity, or to the end of our own publicity, our personal publicity, or our personal identity as the last person.
And if we were to do that, where would that get us analytically that we're not getting otherwise?
Well, it seems like it would take away, or it would take the thrust of the problem of us putting so much information out there and therefore privacy being dead.
Uh-huh.
That seems like that problem would go away. Information about us being out there is only a problem if that information being a secret is what we mean by privacy. But if we mean something more like the capacity to control or to shape how other people understand mm-hmm. us via our sort of mm-hmm. personal publicity.
Yeah.
Is that
well, maybe that gets to the earlier comment about publicity, that we need a word to describe what it is to volunteer information about yourself willfully and with the aim of being a better community member, for instance. And then maybe we do need something to talk about that, because privacy really is so closely associated historically with the domestic, and especially with women's bodies. And I mean, you know, the whole sort of, you see, you know, this is what's good to be someone who studies the hermeneutics of privacy. Yeah. You know, it has such a particular historical association that I think maybe we do need some, like if we want to be able to distinguish that which needs protection and needs to not be killed from yeah. that which is alive because we've given life to it.
Sort of going to the question that you ended the presentation with, and I mean, I do kind of know that history, but the history that I don't know, which I would be really interested to know, is the sort of history of our desire to be public. And I wonder if you've thought
yeah.
about that or written about that.
All right, someone in the audience has thought about that. It's a clever audience. Does anyone, someone writing a dissertation called The Hermeneutics of Publicity?
Right.
You are! Now you're going to! Yeah. No, that's a great point. And I'm just going to echo it in case people didn't hear. The point was about how vital and crucial visibility has been to political movements, thinking just, you know, from the 1950s forward, essentially, you know, the rights revolution movements, beginning with civil rights, the importance of being seen, being identified, coming out of the closet, having your own room, you know, like the importance of visibility to assertions of political rights. And that is a form of publicity that we would celebrate as a public good. The you know, another piece of that is that, you know, the feminist, the personal is political, which is actually also publicizing the personal life for the sake of a political argument, which has a whole analog in memoir culture and confessional culture. And you can trace that if you were writing the dissertation called The Hermeneutics of Publicity, you'd have to have spend a lot of time thinking about why the public confession. I mean, but that, it has all kinds of interesting modern things, but here's my, like, the history of my coffee bean and my coffee cup. Oh, the China trade and my porcelain, whatever. My, like, the public confession has a hugely important long cultural history here in the United States in particular. The conversion narrative, the public testimony of faith. I mean, I guess I just feel like I'm gonna retreat into echoing my main argument, because I love all these other arguments, but I do really think there is something going on that has to do with secularization that elevates our sense of ourselves in a very odd way. So that instead of the public confession being about submission, you know, to God, it is a public confession about one's own power over one's own life. And that puts us kind of in a different place with what we're claiming about why we've gone public with something. Are you sitting for a question?
Oh, my last one. As an ancient historian, I have a longer trajectory. So my trajectory goes, so in thinking about these issues, I wonder to what degree these issues also are framed in terms of legal history. So going all the way back to Hammurabi, making law visible, making law into something that people can consult. With Hammurabi, we know that, in fact, Hammurabi's laws were not consulted. The legal cases that we have from his time show us that what he said about law was not common law. Was not what went on in his courts. So his making visible of the law was irrelevant, and yet it at least put him in a place where he was supposed to be the person consulted. But what that meant for ancient Mesopotamians was that the community knew what the law was. So this entanglement of community vis-a-vis individual and where the law stands in between those two things seems to me to be this big trajectory. So the history of law really comes in, where is the arm of the government, the legal arm of the government, in defining how much anybody knows about anybody else.
So I'm going to ask you to answer the question that the woman over here asked me earlier, because we have ancient history to tell us. Do you wake up and read the newspaper in the morning and say, Jesus, it's all new, everything's new, where is this coming from? Or does it feel to you like it's Hammurabi warmed over?
It's a lot of Hammurabi warmed over.
All right, okay, good, that's all I need to...
But in a much more complicated manner. So Hammurabi was a community of all people who knew each other, whereas our world is a bunch of people who don't know each other, and therefore it's a much more complicated. So the question about the veiled women, in a community of veiled women, everybody knows who everybody else is. But in a global community, nobody knows anybody else.
Yeah.
So that's where then we get the definition by government, by legal means. I don't know. So is this a history of law?
Yes. Oh, I completely agree with your point.
I'm worried about not asking a question.
No. You need to share your erudition with us. Thank you. But yes, you're right. It's the history of law. Yes.
Yeah. So I'm a computer scientist, and I wanted to ask. You were talking about Warren and Brandeis having this argument that snooping in some way was like violating your soul, and it made you less whole. It was like a tort or something. Are people still? And it was clear that he knew that was happening. He like saw the reporters at his door taking pictures of him, and that sort of made him mad. Are people still at this point using that argument against like the NSA PRISM and this idea that, you know, they're processing all of our email without asking us, but we don't really know that they're doing it? They sort of have it and they're looking for things, but it's not really like we can't see them at our window. And I was wondering if that affects, you know, arguments against that. Like, are we trying to close it down? Are we trying to use this, you know, the NSA is violating our soul with that process?
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know that the, I'm trying to think of the most vocal opponents of the NSA stuff are people who are not arguing about violations of individual privacy, frankly. They're people who are arguing about misconduct by governments. So it's really the kind of, it's more the Chelsea Manning phenomenon of, look, this has been hidden from us. It needs to be revealed. Like, there are forms of secrecy that are made possible technologically now. And it's not so much the collecting of information about private citizens that I think people are most eloquent about. It's actually the hiding of information by the government about activities conducted by the government without the approval of the people. But both are about defeating democratic processes, right? About doing things that one has not been granted the power to do by the people, right? But there's not a lot of the kind of Warren and Brandeis, invisible man, you've made me insane thing, which is a big, huge part of the obsession with privacy from the 1890s through the 1930s. A lot of it really is about the kind of the loss of the integrity of one's soul. Do we have that? Do you feel, I don't know, do you see that anywhere as a computer scientist?
No, I mean, first of all, I definitely don't think that the poppy seeds in the letter is possible, sort of theoretically for that, unfortunately. I mean, that's a little aside.
For 1844, or you don't think there's a version of doing it now?
Like, you're never going to
know. Oh, we can't have that kind of protection.
They're just going to snoop it, and the bits get copied, and you have no idea that happened.
You don't, like, secretly send emails saying, like, I don't know, the head of the NSA is...
I mean, the best you can do is, like, throw a tracer flare, like, you know, in the movie The Lives of Others, where the Eastern European guy is, like, saying that he's going to run a smuggling operation just to see if somebody arrests him, you know, and then that would, if they did...
So that's cheeky.
Yeah, right? It's a little bit risky, too. But, and then if they did, then that means that they were listening, right? So that's the best, I think that's the best you can do.
Okay, I'm not doing that. You do that.
No, not me either.
Hi.
Hi. I thought this was fantastic. Thank you very much for giving such a concise and yet thorough history on privacy. My question pertains to the NSA. So I would delineate the NSA activities into sort of two camps or two segments. One are those that they're developing their own internal resources in order to circumvent encryption and to basically compromise systems. And then there's the other sort of consideration with regard to privacy, in which they are basically through certain legal mechanisms requiring third parties, corporations who have acquired information from citizens in a lawful manner. And so citizens basically either implicitly or explicitly provide private information to corporations in exchange for whether it's ease of communication, whatever value they're attaining through these mm-hmm. devices such as the iPhone or services such as email. So my question is, what do you expect or what do you think will be the outcome with regard to sort of like the legal rights of corporations to retain the secrecy or remain proper stewards for the privacy of the citizens who've disclosed that information?
Here's what my theory is. You have crafted such a careful question, I think you have an answer to it.
I don't. I'm very curious because it, from everything I've read, a lot of the larger corporations like your Google, Yahoo, Microsoft, it seems like the government has actually sort of strong-armed them into providing this information. And there was a lot of resistance. And I know, like Google right now, they're finding ways to further protect, encrypt their information. So they're trying to stay sort of one step above what the NSA is devising independently. Mm-hmm. But I'm just curious, I'm not a lawyer, I'm an internet marketer actually. And so I'm kind of...
All is now revealed.
Yeah, I'm just very compelled about sort of the legal rights of these companies versus what the government is requiring them to.
Okay, so me, as just an idiot lay user, I will have to say, the distinction between Google collected all that information about me, but now is suddenly angry at the government for asking for it, I don't make that. The collecting is the thing that bothers me, not the government asking for it, or it bothers me equally as much. So it is a real distinction, the one that you've drawn. And I just say purely as a layperson, it doesn't viscerally hit me in that way. What bugs me most is the collecting of that stuff. Maybe for marketing purposes, but for whatever purposes that it's being collected, that I think could change, because that is the kind of consumer commodity provider model where there's a kind of exchange, a commercial exchange that can be moderated by all kinds of forces that don't require legislation, say. I think that exactly as you say, it is changing. Like Google is changing its position about certain things, and you know Facebook has been sort of scandalized about certain things. So I think there are existing commercial pressures that will recast that relationship to some degree. Mm-hmm. Although I do think the kind of the horses out of the barn is really an issue. Mm-hmm. What forces bear on the Google's answerability to governments, say, or governments' insistence on requesting that information? That lies in a different domain, in a wholly political domain, right, where, as you know, nothing is working. So that I would not be optimistic for change anytime soon.
Can I ask one quick follow-up?
Yeah, yeah.
So what would you ideally seek from corporations with regard to that provision, the disclosure side? Is it an opt-in where one is explicitly acknowledging that they are providing all this information? Is that where you'd like to see things go?
I don't know. I think that maybe that's a step, some way in which the default is none of this is available in any way. But I don't have a great answer for that. But since this is the last question, I'm just going to say that I think all those corporate executives, or should I take more questions? Do you guys want to, are people restless and want to go, or do I want to take a couple more questions? Okay, we have more time. I'll take these two more questions and that'll be it. But if you need to run, just run. Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Hi, in full disclosure, first of all, I really enjoyed the talk. Second of all...
You're allowed to disclose that?
I'm disclosing that, but then the addendum to that is that I'm finishing a book on data protection and privacy law, and then I will be in Europe as a Fulbright scholar doing the same thing and coming up.
Great.
And so a lot of the interesting conversations I hear are very typically American, and that Europeans look at privacy as a human right.
Someone's just trying to squeeze past you there.
Europeans look at privacy as a human right, meaning that all information and all data is bestowed upon ownership to the individual. And so their laws actually cover a lot of things that people have been talking here, mm-hmm. you know, for government and private corporations, the ownership is just bestowed in the individual. A lot of that comes from this idea of informational self-determination, whereas I allow you or anyone or a corporation to know things about me, but I am in control of what you should know about me, and so therefore if I tell you to delete my data, you should delete my data, mm-hmm. and you can't just use it in any way, shape, or form. Mm-hmm. And I see a lot of, with the NSA was not a surprise for me. I knew that they were doing it, so I was like, yeah, okay, the issue is how. And so I see a lot of Americans not having the conversation, in my opinion, that should be, is why don't we have certain control over our data, and mm-hmm. why isn't privacy legislated to give the individual that type of control? And when you look at the laws, I mean, the 1890 was really talking about journalistic, you know, as you know, like coming into your house and that. But, you know, our laws for privacy are so sectoral, meaning we have a law for this and we have a law for this. And you are really in unless you opt out. And then you can't opt out to certain provisions, mm-hmm. because not only has the government fought that, but corporations have fought that. Mm-hmm. So I guess it's like a comment, and I'd also like to hear your, you know, response to it, because my PhD is in history as well, mm-hmm. so I tend to see these things as continuums. But I don't see Americans really grasping, like we think we have these rights, but the fact of the matter is, mm-hmm. it's really not there. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, no, that's a great question, and I'm so happy to hear that you're going to be doing this comparative work as a Fulbright scholar, because these are questions we really need answered. I do think that the likelihood is that we're more of the set of ideas that are commonplace in Europe will have more of a purchase, because privacy advocates are, it's a kind of global movement for one thing, so there's a lot of just slipperiness there. But I do think our particular set of ideas have to do with our weird political history, and its greatness and its terribleness all in one, and so that it does mean that I think that change would be slow to come. Okay, this is going to be the last question, so people can mosey.
Hi, I was just wondering what you make of the argument that, you know, just as people are emailing and Facebook messaging everything, you know, just as the technological advances come, you know, the NSA and other spy agencies have to keep up. You know, I don't think the people, the officials in these agencies are just going to, you know, if we were in charge of these places, we wouldn't just be, you know, relying on, you know, the spy methods of, you know, 1995. So, and, you know, if we want us to keep them, if we want them to keep us safe, you know, what do you make of that argument that just as, you know, social networking is taking over, they have to also adapt to the new world? And so.
Thanks. Yeah. No, I mean, no one, including me, has mentioned the word, you know, security or national security or homeland security or the entire, word box of terms that talks about exactly what you're alluding to here. That the work that's being done is not because people care if I said my cousin is fat, you know, they care if I'm part of a terrorist cell, and that's what the intrusion is about, and you know, I think then the tricky part becomes asking and figuring out what the answer to the question is, whether the only way to frame what is permissible and what is not permissible is if there's this kind of seesaw between privacy and security. And I myself am not convinced that that is the balance that needs to be kept. I think there are, I think that's probably a false way to conceive of the issue. I don't think there are just these, on the one hand there's privacy, on the other hand there's security. If we want the one, you have to have less of the other. It does not intuitively seem to me that that is what's going on. Which is not to say that these matters of security and these investigations don't have all kinds of aren't doing all kinds of important work that we ought to think about. And frankly, I think would think better about if we knew a little bit more about, honestly. Thanks, everybody, very much.